It's been 6 months since we've been on the air, but we're back with an all-new programme with plenty more cutting-edge political chat. Joining us today are the cream of Guild Media, Molly Wright and Lexie Wilson, and later we'll be joined by Vice President for Education, Simon Furse. Welcome back, you're watching the Sunday edition.
Today on the Sunday edition, we're joined by two members of student media societies, Molly Wright, Deputy Station Manager of Student Radio Burn FM, and Lexie Wilson, Deputy Editor of student newspaper Redbrick. Thank you both for being on the Sunday edition. Where do you see the role of student media in the Guild at the moment?
I think the role of student media could definitely be improved upon. At the moment, we do have a limited presence, I would say. Redbrick is stationed across campus and very much in the Guild. But I think that the stretch of Burn FM and GTV could definitely be widened, but we would need an increase of investment, which of course in the current economic climate is looking like an unfortunate state of events.
Do you think with that investment then you would develop further, or do you think there's something else that's needed, or is it just the investment?
Well, no, I would definitely say investment would be a great help. For instance, if we take Burn FM as an example, we are currently transmitting on FM radio for only 2 weeks every year. If we had more investment, we could go on to become a community radio and also buy a larger satellite dish so that we could broadcast to a much greater area. And in doing so, we'd stretch through to Selly Oak, through to Harborne and Edgbaston, and to hopefully a greater span of students and provide them with a better service.
Okay, Lexie?
I think the role of student media in the Guild is something that can't or shouldn't be undermined, certainly, because I think it not only does it provide like a voice for students, or we certainly, I think all three of us certainly aim to give people a forum, both for to find out information and to kind of be able to share their own opinions about what they know and what they feel, but more so it's about creativity as well, because again, each three, both Burn FM, GTV and Redbrick are all teaching people how to use their creativity in new ways and applying skills that can be useful for the rest of their lives, hopefully, and having a great time in the meantime.
How do you see the balance between like funding for the student media groups, but also trying to successfully hold the Guild to account? Well, because for example, like all Guild media groups are funded by the university, by the Guild, but they also have to have a role, surely, in holding the Guild to account through.
I think that's a relationship that's still being defined at the moment, because I think both of those things are completely crucial. We rely on funding from the Guild, because obviously it's in terms of student development, it's something that people are, you know, a lot of people we see come in and actually find it a really useful thing for themselves, as well as enriching their experience all around. But you're right, I think it does need to strive to hold the Guild to account, because it's in terms of representing students both ways. Both in terms of letting them have the experience of, you know, participating in media, as well as holding people that are responsible for their experiences here to account. I think they're both important.
Mm-hmm. Molly,
go on. I was just going to add to that although the Guild does fund us to a certain extent, it is still a political entity which definitely does need to remain transparent. And if there is proper cause, then there should be proper reporting in a non-biased light.
Okay. What does the next year hold for both Burn FM and Redbrick? We'll start with Molly.
I would say Burn FM does have a very bright year ahead. We already have a fabulous sports department, and we're hopefully going to extend upon that with the input of more facilities down at the fields, and which will increase our commentary. But in terms of Burn FM as a whole, the quality of the shows will be increasing. The number of people interested in Burn FM is going up every single year. And the spread of our broadcast will hopefully also improve. So Burn FM is being placed in a good light to progress into another committee, another year, and another batch of students. And of course, with our biggest event, the Guild elections coverage coming up, it was so incredibly successful last year with the cooperation of both Redbrick and GTV. But I think the increased cooperation of all three media groups together, we can top last year and really make it even more professional.
Yeah, I think that's something that's important for us at Redbrick as well, actually, the collaboration between all three incredible societies we've got in the media centre. But for, to be more Redbrick focused for us for the year, we've got we just redesigned both the paper and the website, which we are incredibly excited about, and we're so looking forward to people being able to see both. The new website was launched about a week ago, and the paper's coming out a week, you know, at the end of this coming week. So yeah, we've got a fantastic team of editors, some of whom are starting their first issue, totally in control of their section now. We've got an influx of hopefully new writers coming in and a new team, and it's just looking to kind of push both print and online to the maximum and see what we can do with it, really, see what we can achieve.
Mm-hmm. On a final note, what areas do you think will be controversial this year in Guild politics?
I think that's always a difficult question to call so early on in the year. You know, you can't say anything concrete, largely because, if anything, the interest that I find, especially in Guild politics, is utter unpredictability. But I think the first Guild Council of term will be an interesting one, and see what's thrown up there, because I think there is residual tension from the end of last year that seems to be making itself apparent already. But especially because the last two Guild Councils, if I'm right in saying, didn't have a majority needed to ratify any of the decisions that were made then.
So
the changes that were made, or hopefully made, I think a lot of debate will flare up again around certain issues. But other than that, I think it's going to be fascinating to watch the new team of SABs and see how they and their different ideologies react together and how that all works. But no, I think it's set to be an interesting year.
Molly?
I would have to agree. Lexie's said it really, in the unpredictability of the Guild is the attraction of student politics, I certainly find, at Birmingham. And just as Lexie also said, the subquarity of the last two Guild Councils is certainly going to make for an interesting first one, especially with new Guild Councils arriving. Yeah. It's always a difficult entity to kind of follow. You have to understand the terms, and it's fast debate and with lots of different viewpoints. So I think Guild Council certainly this year will be interesting with the new Guild Council chair and deputy chair. I think the interest of Guild Council will also reflect onto the sabbatical team, especially as has already been mentioned and is quite clear in the makeup of the team, the different ideologies and the interests of the sabbatical officers is certainly set. I think there will be sparks. I don't think there will be quite such events as last year, and certainly if there are, they might be focused in different directions. I have been looking at a lot of the changes that have been made to RAs, and I'm not entirely sure how smoothly they will go down, but we will have to wait and see. It's impossible to predict the future.
Okay, Molly Wright and Lexie Wilson, thank you very much for being on the Sunday edition.
Thank you.
I'm joined now by Simon Furse, Vice President for Education, for the interview. Simon, welcome. First of all, for the benefit of our first year viewers, could you briefly explain the role of VPE?
The Vice President of Education is sort of a sabbatical officer working full time that deals with education in the Guild, so they have a number of remits I sit on, lots and lots of committees doing massively exciting things like university academic regulations and sort of like the student rep system. Well, yeah, I'm also the SAB that looks after the student rep system. As much as that happens.
So it was in the news recently, Nick Clegg's apology. This is the first year where students are having to pay £9,000 a year for tuition fees. Do you think that first years who are watching this now will be satisfied by Nick Clegg's apology?
I didn't really think it would be possible, but I think Nick Clegg's apology made me like him even less. I mean, it wasn't really an apology in any meaningful sense. If you're having an argument with your partner because they cheated on you and they say, "I apologise that I ever pledged to stay faithful in the first place," you'd be seriously annoyed about that. He didn't apologise about raising fees, which is what everyone was really annoyed about. He didn't apologise about lying, about going back on his word. What he apologised for was for breaking the pledge in the first place, which is just totally inadequate and almost worse than saying nothing.
Yeah. So Clegg was, as you pointed out, was very careful to apologise for the pledge, but not the rise in fees. Do you think subsidised fees were ever affordable?
Well, actually, the new system of fees is probably going to cost more money than the old one, in terms that like, especially in the short term, the whole point is that, you know, we've got this big budget deficit. If you accept that line, then it's all about short-term stops in funding. But the new fees, the new system is far more expensive in the short term, because rather than having to sort of allocate £6,000, £7,000 to a student for tuition, which is what they were doing before the fees went up, the government is now having to pay £9,000 fees. And the only reason why that could possibly be seen as cheaper is a kind of accounting trick. They push fees off their balance sheet so they're not counted in the deficit. But this kind of bad accounting is not good for anyone. It's what leads to sort of horrific financial crises. It's not a good idea. And so, yeah, basically, it's not actually cheaper to have fees.
Do you think in the long term, though, it will prove to be cheaper in the end?
Well, at the moment, the government's projections is that the fees will end up turning out to be slightly cheaper. I think they become cheaper, I think, in about 2040, which is, you know, losing more money in the short term so you can make more money in the long term is not necessarily a good idea anyway. And more importantly, the government's projections for how they calculate how much money they are going to lose in terms of people's fees not being paid back is based on the projection that all graduates' earnings will increase by an average of 4.5% every year for the next 30 years until they pay their debt off. So, I mean, if you think that that's going to happen, then you can trust the government's projections and it may well be cheaper. But I think 4.5% is probably quite an unreasonable expectation. And probably the worst thing about this huge amount of loan debt that we've just put onto our government balance sheet is it's extremely unstable. We don't actually know how much of it is going to be paid back. And it's also extremely unstable for students as well. Students don't know how much they are going to end up paying back as well.
Let's move on to your year. What do you hope to achieve as VPE?
I think really the what I would hope to achieve by the end of the year is to look back and say that the union that I sort of, well, I won't leave it because I'll be a guild member next year, but the union when I'm no longer a SAB will be in a stronger position to sort of like campaign for a student-led vision of what a university should be and a student-led vision of education, what education should be, than it was when I started. So I think like a stronger union that can put its views across more forcefully to the university is basically what I would like to see at the end of my year.
Do you believe that your actions this year will always be framed in context by those of your predecessor?
I think one of the bad things, well, it sort of has advantages and disadvantages about student politics, is there's an incredibly high turnover. So in many ways, that's a good thing. Student politics has an extremely short memory. You know, every year a new set of people arrive who have not been involved in it, which in many ways is a good thing, but it does obviously mean that every year you have to start again, you have to sort of recreate the arguments, you have to always make the thing, there's no time to build it up. But one of the nice things is that, yeah, you aren't always done in terms of a long history of student politics, because there's probably hardly anyone at this university who can remember what was happening 4 or 5 years ago even.
Yeah. So let's talk about education at Birmingham. According to the Guardian University Guide, we ranked 30th in the country this year. Last year we were 24th, the year before that we were 30th again. What can you do to ensure that we perform better?
Well, I mean, I sort of take, essentially, I don't think the lead tables are necessarily a particularly good way of looking
at students. Students do use them when they apply to university, so they do have an effect.
I agree, but I mean, so that with lead tables, I think the data from lead tables really has to be taken in context. So they can tell you stuff, but in terms of a ranking position, in order to get a meaningful sense of what that ranking position means, you have to understand the context of the universities you've been ranked against. Now, I understand something of the context of Birmingham, and I do believe that Birmingham's position, I do believe that like Birmingham has been mismanaged over the last few years. But I think the sort of principle of trying to rank universities, the vast majority of which you know very little about, is dangerous, essentially.
Okay. Thank you very much, Simon.
Thanks.
I've been Owen Earwicker.
And I've been Freddie Herzog.
Be sure to join us next week, same time, same place, on the Sunday edition.